you have an element of kth and sub k, and you take the product. So this definition of delta, of the co-product, is exactly made to have that property. That means the multiplicative property of my map is easily seen from the co-product on C of psi.
But if you decompose F times G differently?
No, it works also.
Yeah, the linearity of the co-product are...
It's a general property you have in the bi-algebras, yeah. In fact.
Yeah.
General property of bi-algebras. And in fact, of course, I have not chosen delta arbitrarily. I've chosen delta to be a morphism of algebras. That means if I done that, this implies nothing. And then, and the universal Taylor morphism can be seen very well in that context. Universal Taylor morphism, or exponential. Expansion of vector fields. Vector fields is easily understood in this formalism by the following way.
What is mu?
Multiplication on K.
Multiplication.
Yeah,
but that's not.
Pardon?
Mu.
A mu is a multiplication. It's a multiplication on K. K over C. Multiplication on K.
I don't understand that expression.
Over Z.
So
it's a multiplication.
Yeah.
He has these two things.
Mu is a multiplication.
Two of them. Yeah.
You have. Delta of phi.
Multiplication in K.
Delta of phi is in K tensor K. So you act on F tensor J.
Yes.
You act something on K tensor K.
Yes.
Yeah, and you take the product.
But lambda already moves it. I don't understand what first lambda and then mu.
As types.
Oh, do you not need to do it again?
I wrote lambda. I should have written. That's a square of lambda. Lambda is a map. It's a map from C tensor K to K. I have C of C. I have C of psi. Tensor C of psi. Tensor K. Tensor K. Yeah. I map that. K tensor K. And then I map to K. Here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So now you have to write that in another way.
But what is the statement that you're making here?
Pardon?
Let lambda be. Any map that
lambda, no, lambda is, oh, lambda is, my, is the obvious map, which is psi k f to psi k f. It's the action. Lambda is that action. And then lambda is a map C of psi. Tensor K. All that is over C. Okay? So lambda is equivalent to give C some, I will call lambda star, k into k tensor of c, c of psi. That is standard property, the moving the tensor for that. And what is that dual? You will see exactly than this. You will see exactly than this is the universal map of Umemura or exponential of the vector field. Of, because of C of psi to C, of C of psi to C, you CK, call U some map like that, U, U map CK to some alpha K. Yes. And the co-product on C of psi will give a product on these maps. And you will find alpha k over k factorial multiplied by alpha l over f factorial equals alpha k plus l over k plus f factorial by Leibniz formula, by transposing Leibniz formula. So, maybe I make a mistake. Maybe I make a mistake, no, see. U psi k alpha k, now you have the co-product on C of psi will give a product here. But you will see that you can identify this with on k of psi to C. You will identify on over C K of psi to C. You will identify with K of T, something like that. In fact, yes. Yes. There is just one minute. How to should write om over c k of psi. C. You have. I'm confused. I don't remember if I have to put the factorial k here or in the denominator. Something like that. The co-product here, so I have the time, so I will make the computation in details. In my notes, I have not. So how you do that? The co-product will give a product, U. Product V is what the people call the product convolution product in the theory of algebras, convolution product of V applied to phi equals U of V applied. Delta phi equals usual formula. Your mu is again the product. So if I have u of psi k equal alpha k and v of psi k equal beta k, I have to compute u tensor will be. U tensor will be You convolution V. Say. Psi K. Equals. Sigma. Sigma. L, psi L, psi K minus L, equal sigma K L, alpha L, No, it's not like that. I have to write. The basis. Basis of that space, I'm sorry.
I can never remember this sort of thing with Hopf algebra is about the day after I use it in something that I forget the very next day.
No, I have a basis here. A basis on K of psi. To see, I have a basis. Basis alpha K. KL equals delta KL. So alpha K, I have a basis.
Yeah.
I have infinite series. And this on is sigma lambda K alpha K, but infinite sum. Infinite sum. So I have to take the alpha k, and so alpha psi m equals sigma the alpha k tensor alpha l m p psi p. So psi m minus p. Alors, then you have zero unless and equals k plus m. K.
La somme,
c'est sur M. Non, c'est pas sur M, est
fixé.
P, somme sur P.
Ah.
Je prends le contre-produit.
Ah, oui.
Ça, c'est. Delta xi M. Delta xi M. Alors, to have something different from zero, I should have P equal K and M minus P equal L, or the opposite.
Right, yeah.
That means I have zero if M different from K plus L, and K plus LK if M equals K plus L. So, you have alpha K. And so alpha L equal K plus LK, alpha K plus L. So, if you take alpha k equals k equals k factorial alpha k, you get t k t l equals t k plus l. Which means that you can identify from K of Xi, Xi with K of T with that identification. can identify objects with kind of thing with that identification. So it is, if you want, it's another way, a little bit complicated, to write the exponential of a vector field. It's a way which looks very complicated to write simple things, but in that form it will generalize. That form it will
you're
be
sitting in quiet and you're studying.
And that's the idea of Heinrich, to look at things like that. So
this identification is C vector spaces, isn't it?
Pardon? This identification, identify t to the power k, is identified to k factorial alpha k. And this identification is correct because the product is the good one. I write t sub k, I can write now t to the k.
To the k, yeah.
Instead of t sub k, because my formula of product is the right one.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yes.
So it is C vector spaces.
Pardon? It is the one, in fact, it's a very natural way to look why the factorial come in this object. It's of course just when you iterate the derivation, the factorial comes automatically, but it's a nice way to look at that. If you have some practice with a co-multiplication, you will find that it's in fact a very natural business. It's strange. Now when I learned all that, I wonder that in more traditional education, one do not consider co-multiplication,
no.
Since it's an extremely natural operation. It's just the dual of multiplication.
Yeah.
It's just the dual of multiplication. Bourbaki, mm-hmm. The epsilon of multiplication. There's something
in the train, epsilon. I wonder why. Why do you think?
It's, but the...
Because it's too computational?
Yes, it's computed. Well, you see the people working in quantum groups work with that.
Oh, yeah.
If you see, look at the books by Swigler or the books by Cassel.
Mm-hmm.
It's a computation...
Right.
Yeah. Worked very well with this operation. In fact, when you practice, it's very natural because for groups it's also natural because it's normal to translate the group law in terms of the function on the group.
Right.
It's just a communication.
Right.
So it's in fact an extremely natural object. So now I will just say that. What are, if I write the action? Okay.
This has been looked at before.
So, this is my K. K.
Well, I don't
know. On the side to see, which maybe I cheated a little bit because this product is not exactly on K of psi to C. You have to tensorize from C of psi to K. This is smaller, right? This is smaller than the second one. So I was a little bit too fast, but it's not a very important point. So you have to be a little bit careful because this is similar to the formula that you have this formula, similar to the formula you have when you have a group action. You have group action,
yes.
X, G cross X to X. So you have
C
of G. No, C of X.
That's right. I haven't seen this in this context.
C of X.
Only
C of G.
I haven't used it. I mean, I haven't used it.
C of G. So this is a formula similar to that.
Yeah.
Now you have to be careful you have to be careful that the Hopf algebra, which comes naturally, is not the C of Xi without total multiplication. It's the dual in this one. This is the formal. And this, in fact, you will see that it's a formal group, additive group.
Oh.
This is a formal additive. But the calculation I made proved that it's a formal additive group,
formal
in fact.
Additive group.
It's a formal additive group.
A formal
additive group, not the additive group.
Right.
So you have to be careful because you have to be careful that you have Hopf algebra. The dual is also Hopf algebra, but in general, dual of the basis field, but it's very big in general. So, so it's just formal, which is natural because the formal additive group, you can consider that it's the exponential of a vector field.
Yes. It's close to what Ritt did.
So you can think of the nonlinear Galois theory as an action of the formal additive group or a formal group, in fact. From this point of view, you can consider, if you like, that the nonlinear Galois theory is the action of a formal group.
All written down in papers?
In more or less in the papers, not the one that the first one, which is bigger.
Oh, right.
And, so, and in the paper of Heydrich.
Umemura would refer back.
And the paper of Heydrich, thesis of Heydrich in Barcelona. Thesis of Heydrich. All that is due essentially to Heydrich.
Oh, okay.
And all that is in the thesis of Heydrich.
There's a good note by Sweetler and Rota that has a lot of this. That's
really?
Pretty readable. Yeah, Rota wrote quite a bit about it. I think it's pretty understandable too.
Yes, yeah. It's well written.
Yeah.
Papers of Heydrich are well written.
Yeah.
And where is Heydrich's thesis?
Pardon?
Where would one find it?
Barcelona.
In his page.
Where?
Barcelona.
In his page. In his page. You met.
Uh-huh.
You look at Heydrich. On the web, and you find in here
that's
his
thesis.
Florian Heydrich.
His thesis.
Pardon?
To find him. Yeah. Yes.
You find in his page.
Yes.
On the web.
Go to his website.
His page on the web. There is no problem.
Okay.
What exactly are the results?
Wait. So. That's the beginning. You want to apply that to twisted vector fields. So to twisted vector fields, you will have C of sigma xi. You will have sigma, the automorphism.
Yeah.
Xi is A. Sigma minus eigenvector.
Yeah.
So C of sigma xi is a non-commutative polynomial algebra. You have to give the relations. Sigma xi.
And what is A?
An element of
A. An element of my field.
C of x. Okay.
An element of the field C of x. And any element of the field. So, in general, you will have rather bad formulas, which nobody knows how to study. Then, so,
I apologize, but that notation
C equals B.
It's a plug-in.
Plug-in? Are you sure?
What?
I thought that's what it was, but I didn't check the relation.
Like
yeah. The question was, what does A of sigma minus the identity mean?
A.
Does it mean plug in sigma minus the identity?
Multiplication A sigma minus identity of the identity.
Times.
A times sigma of F minus F.
You see, it's
not
just that.
Okay.
So A means multiplication by A.
Yeah.
If there's any justice, it should mean that.
Pardon?
Right. No.
So you have this relation. So you have this
instead of
polynomial algebra, non-commutative polynomial algebra with that relation. So now you have to give again co-multiplication. Co-multiplication. The co-multiplication, you have no problem because sigma of fg equals sigma of f tensor sigma of g. So you take delta of sigma equals sigma tensor sigma. And you have delta psi of fg equals sigma of f delta of g plus F.
No, that's not so bad. That you have any formulas.
No.
That's amazing.
Plus psi of F G.
Yeah.
So you take delta psi equals.
Is this the commutation relation is strange?
Sigma tensor delta psi plus psi tensor delta.
Use psi.
So you take that. So you should be careful.
Logarithmic derivative.
There is an objection. Objection is here. You have chosen a non-co-commutative co-multiplication to express a multiplicative, a commutative multiplication. Instead, you could have replaced.
Wild.
You could have write one tensor psi plus psi. And something similar, also if you like. So you have to make a choice.
B is not like that.
B psi of A over A, yes.
Is it because, for example, if A is equal to 1?
Yes. But then, I.
Then C of A is equal to 0. So B would be 0, but C and sigma commute.
Pardon me?
It's not C of A over A, it's something else.
If psi equals sigma minus identity, psi, sigma equals sigma psi.
Yes, but C of A, C of 1 is equal to 0.
Oh, no, yes, you are right. Sigma of 1 over A.
Oh, it's sigma A.
Sigma of A over A.
So it's.
Sorry. You're right.
It's not a logarithmic derivative, no.
It's a logarithmic, it's generalized. So.
It would have been better as.
Alexei is right.
Yes, he's right.
So you choose that. So with that, you have a co-algebra, which will be maybe a half algebra if sigma is invertible. Maybe, but I don't know. You cannot expect to have an antipodal map unless sigma is invertible. But anyway, you have a bi-algebra. But that bi-algebra is very complicated, though. At the moment, nobody has tried to do anything with that. So admit that everything works. So you have the universal. What he called universal of map is the map C of psi sigma psi tensor C k to k with the obvious map you take sigma f sigma tensor f to sigma f and psi tensor f to psi of f and then this determines completely the action of non-commutative polynomials because you have written the right extrapolation. And so that map, and that map with the chosen, we have chosen the right co-multiplication in order to have the following property, to have a property similar to the preceding one I wrote for the before, and exactly the same formula will work, which means the following, that this map, if this map gives a map which I don't remember, I call that lambda, that map. So you have lambda star, k tensor k, tensor sur c, on c, c of c max I, ici. And here, the co-multiplication by algebra give here a multiplication. So you have a map from K to K tensor this ring, and the choice, the right choice of the co-multiplication means exactly that this is a morphism of algebras. So the co-multiplication in C of sigma psi is made in order that this map is a morphism of algebras. And so this, he claims, it is, that is the universal Taylor map. And so he can develop, from that, he can develop exactly the basic formalism of Umemura, and he, by definition, blah, 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 the Galois theory is that and that. But of course, you have to make examples. Yeah. And with that very general situation, nobody is able to make calculation.
So what's the point of the formalism then?
What is the point?
Of the formalism, if...
What is the point of the theory?
I don't understand the question.
What is the point of the formalism?
The aim.
What is the advantage to have this formalism?
But it's the advantage is that before that case, you have no theory at all. Is to have a theory, you like to have a Galois theory for map, sigma, psi, which satisfy tens relations. You give two map of my thing which psi, which satisfy this property, you want to make a Galois theory for tens maps.
Non-linear.
Yes. For necessarily non-linear, because they are not linear, the map. You want to have a Galois theory which extend the Galois theory for vector fields or Galois theory for morphisms. And
difference.
But I mean, it still is linear because sigma of f plus g is sigma of f plus sigma of g, and psi of f plus g. It's just that the twist, it's twisted,
yes,
in multiplication.
It's linear on the function, but it's
non-linear.
It's non-linear on the space.
No.
But there's no co-addition, right? So.
No, but it's not linear on the x space.
Yeah.
It's non-linear on the x space. It's linear on the function on x.
Yeah.
But it's non-linear theory, like a vector field is not linear.
Right.
And vector field, if you integrate, you have non-linear equation. So the objective is to have a theory in that situation with test data which extend the non-linear Galois theory for one vector field or one vector. And so the idea of Heydrich is to use, to define that generalization of the universal Taylor morphism. See, this means that you have some formal Hopf algebra which act, and you can at least give the definition. But in such general case, you cannot make any calculation at the moment. And there is another problem, which even in the example I will speak about now, which you can calculate, I cannot make the relation with my point of view. In other words, we should have a notion of quantized groupoid or quantized pseudo group, and we don't have one.
Oh, so that's what this is, quantized.
Quantized pseudo group. We don't have. Probably this formalism should give, in some reasonable sense, quantized pseudogroup. But we don't have at the moment. We don't know what are the right definitions to take. So it's a completely open question. So it's just a beginning theory that, of course, I will look at the example that which can be computed. You can of course believe that it's completely artificial because you have to make at least two choices which are a little bit arbitrary. One, they forget about the relation, this relation, and keep only these relations. You forget that, you keep just these relations, and second, you have the choice, the symmetry here. So you have two choices. You can suppose it's arbitrary, but at the moment, one does not know to do better. Now the example. There is one example. That is the formalism of Heydrich. Now Umemura takes the following example. Umemura from Saito. And take the following example. The example of Q difference, exactly. C of x, one variable. So it's just function of one variable. And you choose Q ici, Q different from zero. And sigma f of x equals f of qx. That means that you will make q difference equation. And the delta f by delta equals 1 over q minus 1 x. Sigma minus identity.
Oh, so q is non equal.
So, when q tends to 1, this means just the derivative.
Oh, okay.
It's a reason of that factor here. So q minus 1 is not necessary, of course, in the machinery. The x is useful because sigma minus identity, if tends to identity, you will get just the derivative. So it's and here the things work well because sigma delta equals 1 over q. Oh, I said delta means psi. Sigma psi sigma. There is another example which is in Ardoin, but where than the example of Ardoin, you get just usual Galois theory, non-commutative. In Ardoin, you take sigma f of x. Where f of x to the q, delta f of x equal x of prime of x. So you find in Ardoin psi sigma, also you have q sigma psi, but you find usual derivation. You find usual derivation, so the co-multiplication, usual multiplication, usual Leibniz formula. So, as you have a formal usual Leibniz formula, you will have a commutative delta. So it's not, if you want to have quantum groups, it's not interesting. But the example is interesting in itself.
Yeah.
Example is in the argument. So, and now I will refer to the paper of Umemura, who calculate a few examples in this context. Umemura and Saito calculate a few examples in this context. Umemura, Saito, they analyze in this context with C of psi delta, sigma psi, in the case where your field are K equal C of X, C of X, X alpha. C of X log X. So they can calculate, see what happens in this example. And in the last paper, they look at a very nice linear example. Because in the whole preceding paper, they said we need nonlinear equation to have quantum groups. And in the last paper, they realized that they could have quantum group also in a linear equation. The linear equation they take is the following. Sigma M1, you have M, M1, M2 equals Q0, 0, 1, M1 and M2, and delta M1 and M2 equals 0, 1, 0, 0, M1 and M2. That looks like a very simple equation that you have to refer, you need to remember that you have. So the relation between sigma and delta, psi, the relation between sigma and psi that I wrote before, you can verify that it's true. And you impose the co-multiplication rules. And then, in this example, they find that they have complete Picard-Vaisseau theory, in this very simple example, with essentially all the properties of Picard-Vaisseau theory, ring without a zero divisor, constant equals C, ring is simple. You have Galois correspondence, and even the Tanakian expression.
But this is a linear system, is it?
Yes.
There's nothing surprising. Is
that? Ah, it's not surprising. You have a question that with that system, you have no Picard-Vaisseau theory if you remain in the. If you remain in commutative algebra, it's easy to see that you have just you cannot have two linearly independent solutions. So you will see in their paper. So you cannot have Picard-Vaisseau extension in the usual sense.
Well, just that Sigmund, Xi don't commute, so, but so what?
But you cannot, try to make a bigger visual extension.
When they don't commute.
So, what's wrong with this?
The fact that they don't commute prohibits a distance of bigger visual extension.
What do you mean? You can...
If you have two solutions, they are linearly dependent. So you have no two, you don't have two linearly independent solutions if you remain in commutative fields.
What do you mean commutative? Where the multiplication is commutative or the...
Multiplicative field. If you remain in multiplicative field, you don't have... If you work with extensions which are multiplicative fields, if you remain in extensions which are multiplicative fields, so if you remain in the Picard Vaisseau theory, you don't have Picard Vaisseau extension because if you have two solutions, they are not linearly independent. I will not make the calculation. Calculation is made in the paper. Calculation is so few lines calculation which is made in this paper. Maybe if I have. So what they do, of course.
Do you understand this?
So what he has to do is to apply his general formalism to find the right extension. So I cannot give the details. It's in this paper. In this paper.
Do I understand why there doesn't exist?
Yeah.
You have to. That's how I get at it.
The calculation is made here. If you have two solutions, if I have lemma L de sigma K, sigma, psi, extension, an extension. If you have a 2x2 matrix Y with sigma Y equals Q0, 0, 1, Y, and psi Y equals 0, 1, 0, 0, Y, then the two lines calculation prove that determinant y equals zero.
Ah, so it doesn't imply that it's not completely integrable.
Well, whatever that means,
what
these
mean?
Are not two derivations.
They are not derivations. They are not derivations.
You can do the same thing with endomorphisms.
With an endomorphism and a twisted derivation?
So this is an endomorphism. There are two endomorphisms.
Two endomorphisms.
C is an endomorphism.
Yes. But however, in this context, non-linear context, you have a Picard Vaisseau theory.
Yes, I'm asking that if you apply C to the first equation and sigma to the second, and multiply after that the second by the constant of commutation and subtract,
yeah.
I suppose you're not going to get zero.
No.
So that's the reason why I don't have an invertible. That's all. So
probably, but that's not the point. The point is you do have a Picard Vaisseau extension theory, but not commutative.
So that does mean that they propose how to deal with non-completely integrable systems.
not any completely integrable systems. Not any kind. It's very special kinds. Special kinds, a non-integrable system. It's a system, you have relation sigma psi equals q psi sigma or q minus one. This is not, it's in a relation you never get with derivations.
Here?
Wait, what if...
You never get this with derivation.
Here you get with the derivation and an endomorphism.
Yes.
Two endpoints. They're one and one.
Yes.
Is it one of them endomorphism, the other derivation?
No, I don't
no?
think it's
No, they're two endomorphisms?
Yeah, because he's not really doing differential equations.
It's different equations?
It's different equations,
Maybe with different equations you will
difference.
Get, of course.
It's a pity that only one was sleeping. He told me that he would see the recording. Otherwise, he would ask questions and he would comment on it.
Yeah. Who?
Umemura. Umemura is watching it. But he will watch it he will watch it tomorrow when he wakes up.
Then you'll get questions.
Well,
or
so the point, I can give you a few formulas. Yes, but the formula is, when you use the, I will just say a few words, when you use the general formalism I explained, I will not give
the equations.
I will not give the details of the computation, the details are not very difficult, but they are in the paper. What you find is the following.
Oh, I see, that gives you the structure.
You find, you have a new variable,
where they are
x, t, q, with qx equal small q, x, capital q. And the ring you have is C of X Q minus 1. And it's a, it claims that this is a big extension with this new variable. But you have two solutions. You have solutions.
Is it just
following solutions?
It's just adding Q to the
zero.
Ring.
No. Okay. Oh. Yeah. I thought zero. It's zero.
So he's taking polynomials in Q and Q inverse?
Yeah.
With coefficients in C. Yeah.
That's clear.
It's 5 o'clock in the morning in Tokyo.
Alright.
You have seen that. Q. Q.
Maybe it gets up early.
Psi of Q. It was zero. Sigma of T. It's X. It was QX. And
these are the people who see.
Psi of X equal one.
Well, that's not clear, but he said there is one. He gets the universal.
Yeah.
And you take the so you have the solution is the following: Q zero T one. Yes, the generalized Picard ratio solution is that.
That's
Q is a new variable. But of course, you have to take a non-commutative extension. And in their computation, they find naturally a Galois group here. These are linear theories, so you have a Galois group, which is the Hopf algebra, the dual of the quantum group you read, the Hopf algebra. The following Hopf algebra is C of U minus 1 V with UV equals QVU. I should give U minus 1 V, and of course I should give the, it does not give here the multiplication. Delta does not give.
Yeah.
And so he gives a Hopf algebra, which is naturally the Galois group of that equation.
Right.
So of course it's a extremely simple example, but it's almost the only one. But it's you have six or eight pages.
I take it back. This so Q is just an element of C, correct?
No, U is.
No, there. So in that example.
Here.
In the left hand side, in the example.
Correct.
Oh, must be.
So then it is completely integrable because the sigma and C F. Trivial on the matrices.
No, but U and V, some other variable, they are not in this field. It's in, they're in the Galois group.
No, but with the original equation, difference equation, Q is in, what's the base field of?
Base field C of X.
C of X, so Q is in C of X?
What's Q is Q? In C.
Q is in C. Q is in C. Q is in C. Number. Right, yes, so it is, of course, in
theory. Right. Q is different from zero.
Yes.
But I guess
Q is different from one, of course.
Wish we could do
otherwise,
it. Two
otherwise, yeah, the theory is trivial if Q equals one.
Or did you write down the solution?
Right, right. I got that from Lucia. Lucia,
sure, but here.
You say? Lucia,
Lucia.
It's
Italian.
Yeah, I was going to say it's not French, it's Italian.
It's Italian.
But she corrected me when I said Lucia. She said Lucia. Lucia.
Lucia.
Lucia.
It's Italian.
In French,
we
say Lucia.
Lucia.
In French, people say Lucia.
Oh, you don't?
No, we don't say.
You say Lucia.
So, if you want more details, you look at their papers.
Yeah, yeah.
But
we should read that a little bit. Yeah.
So, of course, one should look at other examples. One should try to have more systematic theory. Yeah. And for me, one of the main problems is to have interpretation in terms of pseudogroups.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I have no interpretation in terms of pseudogroup. I don't know what is a quantized Lie pseudogroup.
Groupoid.
No, groupoid don't matter.
No.
Because the pseudogroup is a inverse limit. It's right, inverse limit of groupoid, so it's inverse limit of groupoid, so it don't direct limit. But in the jet space, in each K, you have a groupoid, so it's a pro-groupoid.
And you don't know whether there's a groupoid.
It's a pro-groupoid at infinite order. At infinite order, it's an inverse limit of groupoid.
Right.
Was that example artificial, or that example corresponds to something interesting?
That's a problem.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Yeah. You can consider it artificial, or you can consider, as everything works perfectly well in that example, it's, in any case, it's intriguing. You cannot decide at the moment, it's a very important example, but it's at least intriguing.
It's easy example.
Well, you said it's basically the only example.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, no, that's why it's important that this
other non-linear example. Yeah. Basically, the only one linear example. Yeah.
Linear example. Yeah. And you say it generalizes. What does it generalize? What doesn't generalize?
I don't know. You should work with other sigma than this one. Just with the Q difference. But already have a good theory in Q difference would not be so bad.
That's true, yeah. What's it? Lucia is working on it, and Charlotte? Do they work on Q difference theory?
Lucia, of course.
Lucia and...
Adouin.
Yeah, so the parameterized Picard, so yeah.
Charlotte, yes.
And Michael Widmer?
Yes, yeah. they work on quite Q difference, of course. Yeah. Their main work is on Q difference.
Yeah, I don't know anything about that.
The proof of Grothendieck conjecture for Q difference.
Right.
Yes, it's
that's very nice.
The first paper of
Lucia. Yeah. And Yves André, is it?
I don't know. Yves André tried to get, he did not succeed to have a quantum group, but in his paper, he tried to get it. He did not succeed. But he made linear theory with a point of view, Tanakian point of view. I don't know if you can have a quantum group with a Tanakian point of view.
Oh, do you know?
I don't know.
Can you have a quantum group?
So you have looked at the Tanakian point of view. So,
yes,
so
yeah. But in general.
Yes.
Yeah. Right. Not this.
Yes.
I'm surprised by it.
Yes, but it is surprised. It isn't everybody's surprised.
Yeah.
Everybody's surprised that the example is especially simple. So.
Yeah.